in the new earth, the new heaven. But until that time, we live in this city. So as we're preparing to live forever in New Jerusalem, we have work to do in this city, Metro Heaven. Good morning, everyone. Glad that you're here. We continue our theme in Acts chapter 18, sermon series, Unhindered. Book of Acts describes for us the unhindered story of the advance of God's kingdom in the earth. Now, you see this on the front cover of your bulletin this morning, a heart for the city. You have to turn a little bit sideways. We purposely did that so you could actually turn it to read it. We want to call you to prayer for our city. Pray, stop and pray every day at 10, 2, and 4. Now, where I got that idea was that when I was a young boy living in Texas, one of my favorite drinks was Dr. Pepper. I don't know if you've ever heard or seen or tasted Dr. Pepper, but that was one of my favorite drinks. And when I was growing up, they had little commercials and little jingles that reminded you to drink Dr. Pepper at 10, 2, and 4. So I thought, what a great idea. Not drink Dr. Pepper, although that's a good idea. But let's stop and pray every day at 10, 2, and 4. And let's pray for God's Holy Spirit to work in our lives and to work in this city, to reach this city with the good news of Christ, to saturate this city with the gospel of Christ. Now, as I spoke last week, the population of the greater urban area that is Metro Manila is about 24 billion people. That's a lot. But let me tell you, there is a global migration to the cities. Did you know that every week, globally, I'm not talking about Philippines, but globally, every week, 3 million people move to a city. Cities are growing so fast that sociologists tell us that by 2040, I almost said 1940, by 2040, two-thirds of the world's population will live in urban centers, cities. Right now, it's about 53%. But by 2040, two-thirds, 67% of the world's population will live in cities. I checked, and Metro Manila is growing by almost 2% a year. So what that means is that by 2040, the population of Metro Manila will probably be between 35 and 40 million people. That is a lot of people. How do you reach that many people? Well, when I was a young boy working on the farm, I will never forget the first day that I came to the farm to work. It was a dairy farm. We were milking cows. And when we had milked all the cows, my boss handed me a shovel and he said, clean out the barn. So I walked out into the holding barn where the 120 cows had been. And it was this deep from wall to wall in cow manure. I thought, my goodness, how? And I said it out loud, how am I going to clean up this barn? To which my boss said, one shovel at a time. How are we going to reach the people of Manila with the gospel? One person at a time. So let's begin. We have a great passion, great vision to want to reach this great city with the good news of Christ. But that's a lot of people. That's a big area. So let's narrow our focus down for maybe as we begin. And maybe we should start with Makati and the adjacent cities. Makati. So we have Makati, Mandaluyong, Karanake, Pasay, Pasig, Pateros, Taguig. These seven cities that are right here. Makati of these six cities that are adjacent to us. Here are their populations. Makati, Mandaluyong, Karanake, Pasay, Pasig, Pateros, aquí. Total population, 3,676,000 people. Now that's still a lot of people. And we're going to shrink that down by finding out where we live in these cities and begin finding ways to mobilize you to reach your condo high-rise, to reach your neighborhood, to reach your school, your workplace, your barangay. You need an elephant, one bite at a time. You reach a city, one person at a time. And as I said last week, it's going to require full participation. How can we saturate these cities with the good news of Jesus Christ? How do we do it? Well, God places the body of Christ, which is International Baptist Church of Manila, God places us during the week in various places of the city. You're moving in the city, you and I, all of us. It's going to take all of us. For today, I want us to go to Corinth. Corinth was a great city in the Roman Empire. I want us to see a vision. Paul had a vision in the night. So we're going to study Acts 18, 1-21 today to find out the kind of people God can use to reach a big city with the good news of Jesus Christ. But first, let's get ready. Let's get ready for God's Word. So let's pray this prayer to God. Out loud, everybody at once, let's pray this prayer to God. Holy Spirit, open my eyes and set my mind to discover your truth, eternal treasures to find. This word in my hand, I will place in my heart to obey in full, never in part. Half obedience, partial obedience is disobedience. Lord, it is our intention to obey you in every part. We want your word to saturate our minds, our hearts, that it becomes the bloodstream that flows through our bodies, our life in Christ. We acknowledge to you that we are hungry for your word. We are thirsty for righteousness. We have a passion for justice and a passion for the gospel. What you have called us to do, the task that you have set before us, to saturate this city with the good news of Christ, is much bigger than we. But your Holy Spirit will teach us today, can empower us and equip us, and put us to work to accomplish the task. And so, Lord, we pray right now that by your word, the teaching of your Holy Spirit, you will equip us to reach this city of Christ. Pray in his name. Amen. So before we tackle these 21 verses, let me give you some introduction to the world of Corinth. Corinth was only a 50-mile journey from Athens. So Paul, we see in verse 1, travels from Athens to Corinth. It was only 50 miles. What is that? Maybe 70 kilometers. A short journey by our standards today. But Corinth was a world away from For one, Athens was a relatively small city. About 30 to 35,000 people lived in Athens. But 700,000 people lived in Corinth. That was one of the largest cities in the empire at that time. 700,000 people. We'll talk in a little bit about who were those 700,000, but it was a large city. Athens was a city of the elite, the highly educated, the philosophers. It was a university center. Corinth, on the other hand, was a trade center. Quite different from Athens. It had a strategic setting on the map. Here's the map. There's Corinth. You see Athens, you see Corinth. Hang on a second. There we go. So you see Corinth here, you see Athens here, and you see this little place right here, this little piece of land in between? That's called an isthmus. It's a little connector between continental Greece, mainland Greece, and this region of Achaia. Not an island, but almost. Little bitty isthmus, a piece of land, a strip of land that connected the rest of Greece. It was about 4 kilometers wide. And notice that there's sea, the Aegean Sea on the right and the Corinth Sea on the left. And these were major shipping lanes. Now, today, if I can bring it up. Here we go. Here we go. Now today, they have cut a canal across the isthmus where tugboats or towboats can pull ships through to get to the other side. But of course, there was no dynamite in Paul's day. So they set up a system of greased logs, and slaves would tug the ships across the isthmus to the other side. Clever. Required a lot of men to pull those ships. So it had a strategic setting. There were seagoing trade routes, and there were the Roman highways that connected Corinth to the rest of the Roman Empire. So that was a very strategic place in the Roman Empire. It had a very diverse population. You can imagine with all the seagoing vessels coming through and all the trade routes, the highways coming through, a great diverse city. Jews, Greeks, Romans, people from all over the world, rich, poor. Now, I mentioned a moment ago that the population was 700,000. 500,000 of the 700,000 were slaves. 200,000 freed. A very diverse population. And from Corinth, all kinds of merchandise would be shipped. Do you see why Paul placed a great strategy on the city of Corinth? His hope was that not only goods would be shipped from Corinth, but the gospel would also be shipped. Now let's go on. Not only did it have a diverse population, it was a very prosperous society. Very rich. A lot of merchandise, a lot of buying and selling, a lot of trade. A very prosperous society. But it was a very promiscuous culture. Many gods, like most Greek and Roman cities, many gods worshipped in Corinth. But Corinth was the center of the worship of Aphrodite, or some people pronounce it Aphrodites. Are you familiar with that goddess? It's the goddess of sensuality. There was a great, mighty temple on the hill top of the city of Corinth, where the goddess of sensuality and fertility was worshipped. And every evening, 1,000 prostitutes would go from the temple down into the city to lead men and women in orgies of worship. And you heard it right, orgies of worship to this goddess. Corinth was a very immoral city. So immoral was it that the name of the city became a euphemism for people who were immoral. If a person was promiscuous, if a person was extremely immoral, in that day they would call them a Corinthian. And they would call their acts of immorality to Corinthians. It's a very sinful, immoral dark city. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm thinking that there are a lot of similarities between the first century court and 21st century Manila. Here we are, a great city of the country of the Philippines. It is a world away from Pampanga and Rizal and Batangas and Laguna to the city of Manila. Big difference between Metro Manila and the provinces. Relatively speaking, Metro Manila, and especially where our church campus is in Makati City, is very prosperous. A great diverse population in this city of 24 million people. Why, there are 80 embassies just in short travel from this campus. We have some ambassadors in this room. Our church family is very diverse. Our city, immoral, corruption, sensuality, spiritual darkness, a lot of similarities. So we can learn a lot from Paul today, the kind of people we need to be in order for God to use us to reach this city. So let's look at Paul in Corinth. And let's learn today. Let's look at the first four verses of chapter 18. Chapter of Acts, verses 1 to 4. After this, Paul left from Athens and went to Corinth, where he found a Jewish man named Aquila, a native of Pontus, who had recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had ordered all the Jews to leave Rome. Paul came to them, and being of the same occupation, stayed with them and worked, for they were tent makers by trade. He reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and tried to persuade both Jews and Greeks. So in these first four verses, we see a man with a trade. How many of you have a trade? Anybody in here have work, career, a job? Yes, we do. God uses people who have work, who have a trade. We tend to see Paul as only a missionary. But Paul had a trade. He comes to Corinth. He needs to sustain himself. Paul never asked payment from any of the churches that he planted. He sustained himself. And so to sustain himself, he applied his trade. He was a tent maker. He went to work. And it was because he was putting his trade to work that he met two Romans named Aquila and Priscilla. And by working with them, Paul obviously shared the gospel because they became believers in Christ. And if you look at verse 18, 19. Paul leaves them in Ephesus to be a church planting, pastoring, disciple-making team. If we're going to reach this city for Christ, we will deploy our careers and our trades and our skills and our hobbies and everything about us to reach people with the good news of Christ. Who is the best person to reach an architect? Probably an architect. Who's the best person to reach a student? More than likely, a student. Who's the best person to reach a teacher? More than likely, a teacher. Who's the best person to reach a taxi driver? More than likely, a taxi driver. You get the point? So I want to call us to attention today that God has shaped each one of us to reach people. Let's talk about that shape. If you are a follower of Christ, God has given you spiritual gifts. These are spiritual skills and abilities that you did not necessarily learn on your own. The Holy Spirit endowed you with these gifts to serve. It might be teaching. It might be leading. It might be giving. You might have the gift of faith, the gift of mercy, the gift of helping, the gift of service. There are a variety of gifts. And every follower of Christ has at least one. usually multiple gifts. Every time we do a spiritual gift inventory in our church body, people discover that they have 3 or 4 or 5 spiritual gifts. So part of your shape is the spiritual gifts that the Holy Spirit gave you the moment you surrendered your life to Jesus. Now, sad news is that many people in the body of Christ, and I'm not just talking about here at IBC Manila, but many people in the worldwide body of Christ are not using their spiritual gifts to serve the church and the world. We want to change that trend. We want to help you. We want to mobilize you. Age. God's given you a heart. You have a passion. There are things that you love to do. There are issues and causes that are important to you. A heart, a passion. Every one of us have received a heart, a passion, a love for people. That's part of your shape. You have natural abilities that came at your birth. Abilities that you develop through training and education and practice. Abilities. Some of you may be a carpenter. Some of you may be a painter. Some of you might be a singer. Some of you might be just a very friendly person. You have the ability to make acquaintances and to encourage people. Some people might be a teacher. Some people might be, you name it, name your ability. It's part of our shape. The abilities that God gives us at birth, abilities that we develop through training. And every person has a personality. And it's very unique. Remember last week, we looked at the first few verses of Jeremiah and discovered that from our womb, while we were in the womb, God, in that secret compartment where only He could see, He shaped us and made us and weaved us and formed us and put us together. He gave us a personality. Some people are quiet. Some people are loud. Some people are exuberant. Some people are quiet. God has given you a personality. And whatever personality you have, that's a good thing. And it's part of your shape. And part of what God can use to reach this city. And He's given you experience. Things that you've done in the past. You've learned. You've grown. You've developed. Experience. All of these things we call our shape for service and ministry in the body of Christ and in the world. We see in these first 4 verses of Acts chapter 18, a man with a trade, a man putting all of his shape in action to reach people with the gospel. And that's what it takes. People with a trade. And we are people with a trade, with a shape. God can use you to reach this city. Aren't you excited? Aren't you encouraged that God can use you to reach this city? Now, let's move to verse 5. In verse 5, we see a man with a witness. Let's read those verses, 5 through 8. When Silas and Timothy came down from Macedonia, Paul was occupied with preaching the message and solemnly testified to the Jews that the Messiah is Jesus. When they resisted and blasphemed, he shook out his clothes and told them, "Your blood is on your own heads. I am clean. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles." So he left there and went to the house of a man named Titius Justus, a worshiper of God, whose house was next door to the synagogue. In other words, Paul didn't go very far from the synagogue, did he? Right next door. In fact, this phrase implies that the synagogue and Titius' house shared a wall. Anyway, Crispus, the leader of the synagogue, believed the Lord, along with his whole household, and many of the Corinthians, when they heard, believed and were baptized. Paul had a witness. And he shared that witness wherever he went. And it was a passion. Notice that there were a variety of responses to his witness. We've seen that before, and we'll see it again in the book of Acts. Some responded, some reacted. Some believed, some did not. Now, what did it mean when Paul shook out his clothes and said to the Jews, "Your blood is on your own hands. I'm going to the Gentiles from now on." This is an important principle. So if you're taking notes, stop just for a moment and listen to this. This is really important. We need to share the gospel with every person possible. But we also need to listen to the Holy Spirit. Because if we listen to the Holy Spirit, we will discover that some people are more ready to listen to the gospel than others. So while we want to share the gospel any opportunity we have, we want to focus most of our attention and energy upon those who are more likely to receive. And let me just say this. That's the work of an effective disciple maker. An effective disciple maker does everything he or she can to love every person that God places in their path. At the same time, an effective disciple maker invests his or her heart into those who are hungry and teachable and ready. So while we're sharing the gospel all over the city, let's pay attention to those who are really ready to receive the gospel. So we see in Corinth a man with the witness, and we have here in Metro Manila, through the people that are the body of Christ of International Baptist Church of Manila, we have people with the witness. Are we sharing it? God gave us a mouth. Let's use it. More about that later. Let's move on to verse 9. The three verses 9 through 11, we see a God with a vision. The Lord said to Paul in a night vision, "Don't be afraid, but keep on speaking, and don't be silent. For I am with you, and no one will lay a hand on you to hurt you, because I have many people in this city." And Paul stayed there a year and a half, teaching the Word of God among them. Now, note this. Even missionaries get frightened. Obviously, Paul was fearful. Why would God come to him at night in a vision, in a dream, and say, "Don't be afraid"? Missionaries get frightened. As we share the gospel, as we go into the darkness with the light of Christ, we're going to encounter people, circumstances, and conditions, and all kinds of things that, in the human flesh, are going to frighten us. Quite frankly, to think about this vision that God has given us to reach this city frightens me. So, get this. Okay, if you're writing notes, stop just for a moment. Listen to this. God responds to our fears and emotions. Look at what God did. He said to Paul, "Fear not." He said to Paul, "Speak out." Why? "Because I am with you." That reminds me of Jesus' great commission to us. "Therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all of my commands. And behold," take note, don't forget, always remember what? "I will be with you always, even to the very end." We can take that in so many ways. To the very ends of the earth, to every corner of the city, to every place we go, He is with us. And to the very end of our life, to the very end of the world. From start to finish, Christ is with us. But what else did God say? He said, "I have many people in this city. In other words, I am moving among the people. So get this. We can be confident that as we obey Christ and move into the city, not only is Christ with us, but God is moving before us, preparing people to hear and see and observe and respond to the gospel. God had a vision. God has given us a vision. And this visionary God will calm our fears, will give us boldness to speak, will always be present with us, and is even working before us to prepare the way. I like that. That inspires me to just want to close the book and go now. How about you? Let's move on. Let's move on and see not only a God with a mission, but a people with an agenda. Verses 12 to 17. While Gallio was proconsul of Achaia, the Jews made a united attack against Paul and brought him to the judge's bench. This man, they said, persuades people to worship God contrary to the law. And as Paul was about to open his mouth, Gallio said to the Jews, if it were a matter of a crime or a moral evil, it would be reasonable for me to put up with you, Jews. But if these are questions about words, names, and your own law, see to it yourselves. I don't want to be a judge of such things. So he drove them from the judge's bench. Then they all seized Sosthenes, the leader of the synagogue, and beat him in front of the judge's bench. But none of these things concerned the leader. Wow. We will find that as we move, as we penetrate, as we go to the many people of this great city, we're going to find people with an agenda. And you know what the agenda is? I can manage my own life. Thank you very much. I'm the ruler of my life. I don't want this Jesus. And there will be some who have the agenda to stop, to silence, to put a halt to our work. But we cannot stop. Here's one clue. Did you notice what happened to the ruler of the synagogue, Sosthenes? What happened to him? Was beaten up. Okay, now, keep your thumb in Acts 18. Now, move over to 1 Corinthians. Remember, Paul wrote probably three letters to the church in Corinth. You have two. There's one, at least one, that we're pretty sure is missing. Well, look at 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 1. Look at this. Paul, called as an apostle of Christ Jesus by God's will, and our brothers, Sosthenes. Even in persecution, even in the context of people who have an agenda to shut us up, God reigns. So again, fear not. Do not be silent. Speak out. Blessed are you who suffer, who are persecuted for my name's sake, for great is your reward in heaven. We put far too much emphasis on worldly wealth. But let me tell you this. When I go to heaven, I want to be rich. And my riches in heaven have a correlation to my obedience on earth. If I serve God faithfully, if I faithfully share the gospel, make disciples, love people, serve people, I am storing up in my eternal bank account rewards from God that are far greater than a gazillion dollars on earth. Yes, there are people who will have an agenda and will work against us, but we serve a God who is on the move, and we see Paul on the move, and verses 18 to 21, it says, so Paul, having stayed on for many days, said goodbye to the brothers and sailed away to Syria. Priscilla and Aquila were with him. He shaved his head at Cenchrea because he had taken a vow. When they reached Ephesus, he left them, Priscilla and Aquila, left them there, but he himself entered the synagogue and engaged in discussion with the Jews. And though they asked him to stay for a little while, he declined, but said goodbye and said, I'll come back to you again if God wills. Then he set sail for Ephesus. We know that he did return to Ephesus. The point there is that Paul was a man on the move, and he was moving by the will of God. And if we will be people on the move, moving by the will of God all over this city, it's a wonder. It's amazing what God will accomplish through us. Now what? What's the point? Where do we go from here? What's the point of God's message to us? Well, number one, just to remind you, God shapes me for ministry in the world. It is my responsibility to discover my shape and surrender it all to God. We will reach this city one person at a time when we all discover our shape, surrender it to God and the Word. It's going to take more than three pastors. It's going to take more than three pastors and five ministry coordinators. It's going to take more than three pastors, five ministry coordinators, and our greater leadership team of about 10 others. It's going to take all of us discovering our shape and getting to work with the good news of Christ. Point number two. If I am obedient to God, listen carefully, He will move in ways I could never expect to accomplish what I could never imagine. Let me just say that again. If I am obedient to God, He will move in ways I could never expect to accomplish what I could never imagine. Greater things are yet to come. Greater things will be done in this city. When Jesus was speaking to His disciples before He left them, He said, greater things will you do than all that I have done. How could that possibly be? He's not talking about quality. He's talking about quantity. The genius of God's plan is that He sent His Son to die on the cross for our sins so we could be atoned to God and have an eternal relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ, who then gives us the Holy Spirit, who empowers, equips, mobilizes us to spread the gospel all over the world. Jesus was limited to a geographical location, but now the body of Christ is unlimited and unhindered. Genius. But it depends upon, it really does, it depends upon God's obedient people moving by God's powerful Spirit. That's how we do this. A couple more things. God never dismisses my human emotions and fears. By this I mean that God doesn't ignore my emotions. He doesn't say, David, how dare you be afraid? He responds to my emotions. He responds to me. And sometimes He uses the emotion. Sometimes He reshapes the emotion. He calms my fears. He gives me courage. All emotions are God-given. If we will just surrender them to God. God will approach me in the darkest night to give me a vision, to give me a promise, to give me a hope for future ministry. God did this to Paul. He was good with us. The fact is, when Paul entered Corinth, it was a very pagan, immoral city, and it remained so for its history. But Paul planted a church there, and it became a strong church, though it did struggle, and Paul wrote two letters to correct them. But it was a strong church making disciples in this pagan city. God can do the same right here through us in Metro Manila. And last, God is able to orchestrate whatever is necessary for my defense. He did that in an unusual way with Galileo. God is able to orchestrate whatever is necessary for my defense and the continued expansion of the gospel of Christ. And last, my mission is not complete until I've trained someone to take my place. Our mission is not just to do it, but it's to disciple people to continue the work. So let's get ready. Let's surrender. Let's get excited. Let's praise the Lord. Let's obey Him. Let's live out, flesh out, incarnate the gospel of Jesus to a watching world. Let's get ready to obey God's word. Let's share the gospel. One shovel. One word. One message. One touch at a time. God used Paul in the first century. This same God who has not changed, this same God who still has a passion for the lost of this city, will use us in the 21st century to reach this city, Metro Manila, with the gospel of Christ. Let's get ready to obey God's word. Four questions. Question number one. What truth did God's word reveal to you today? On your note sheet, just very quickly, it will probably pop into your head soon. What's one truth that God's word reveals to you today? God's truth is a treasure. Think about it for a moment. Why is this a treasure in your life? What difference will it make? How will it shape you and help you find your shape? Third question. What are the steps of obedience to this truth? What steps of obedience to this truth? Write it down. It could be speak out rather than keep silent. It could be forgive someone rather than remain bitter and harmful. It could mean go to bed 30 minutes earlier and wake up 30 minutes earlier to spend some time alone with God and His Word. It may be simply to ask God, God, I'm not sure what the next step is. So God, I'm listening. You show me what steps of obedience I need to take. I want you to imagine this. What difference? How will full obedience affect your life and impact your world? Because that's what we're here for. We're here to impact the world, our world, God's world. Now just take a few moments. Turn to the person next to you, just for a few moments, and imagine with each other what our obedience to God's truth today, how that obedience to God's truth today will impact the people around us. Just take a few minutes to answer that last question. How will my obedience impact the people that I know? Spend a few moments talking to the person here.